Hey guys, can you hear me? My voice is a wreck. Y'all give me an audio report. Hey Ivan, hey Boost, Chandra, Tater, Mills, Catch, and Kahoot. Thank you, Millie. Can you guys hear me? Okay, can you hear me okay? Do I need to make any adjustments? Yeah, like I said, I got no voice left, guys, and I'll do the best I can. Kind of sore still a little bit, but I'm going to work on this coffee and see what we can come up with. And as you guys know, we have a special guest in the studio tonight, and it's Tater. Y'all say hey to Tater. He's going to be answering your questions. He's got his keyboard here, and so he'll be answering your questions in the chat since Taters can't really talk. But, yeah, we have Tater with us, and we're real happy about that. And he'll be available for questions. Anyway, so guys, man, we've talked about a lot of stuff in the past week or maybe more. Been hard to keep up with. I was just thinking about another issue that I've forgotten because of laying up with fever and stuff, but we're going to get it squared away. But we've talked about a lot of things over the last week or 10 days or so, and a lot of interesting topics have come up. And so you guys know that whatever it is that y'all want to talk about is where we're going to go. Y'all talk to me. Tell me what you're thinking. That's what I'm thinking. Got my Bojangles cup here because it keeps the coffee warm for a long time. Creation, well, that's a very, very interesting. And the two witnesses, Millie, you brought that up, mentioned a film. Do you want to post a link for that? It's perfectly okay if you do. And I saw your recommendation for it, excuse me, earlier. And I intend to check it out. It seems quite interesting. Yeah, well, Ivan, you know, we discussed that a little earlier. Ivan, there's a very good video in the study group playlist that really is Dr. Jason Lyles, and he talks about that. I tend to side with him. Now, I think you're familiar with, I know someone here is familiar of Hugh Ross, and Hugh varies. He thinks he's a believer, but he's a an old earth believer, and I've heard him and Jason have a debate, and I lean towards the Bible being literal, and I believe 6,000 years is going to be closer. The two witnesses we can look at here. I don't know, personally, I don't know a lot about the two witnesses. I'm not sure if anyone really does. You guys have heard me say before that, you know, pretty much throughout Christianity, the candidates are Moses, Enoch, and Elijah. And for many years, I was a proponent that that one of them would be Enoch. I have veered off from that for really one good reason, and that is if we look in the scriptures at the key moments, there are two witnesses there, and bear in mind now that witnesses are people that witnessed the event. They saw it happen, and for God's witnesses to be credible, in which you know they will be the most credible ever. In order for God's witnesses to be credible, they would have had to been there. Well, these key moments are things such as the transfiguration of Christ, and it tells us quite simply and succinctly that Moses and Elijah were there. And then, of course, you know, at the resurrection, there were two men dressed in white. Many assumed them to be angels, but I think it was Moses and Elijah. And then at the ascension of Christ, there was also two men dressed in white linen. And again, I believe they to be Moses and Elijah. Hey, Jess, thank you. And it's going to be Revelation. Pam, I'm going to have to guess. Shoot from the hip. I'm thinking 7, but I think that's wrong. So that, you know, what I think don't really help. Yeah, that's the 144,000. 11. Let's try 11. Yep. Chapter 11. And there was given me a reed like unto a rod, and the angel stood, saying, Rise and measure the temple of God and the altar and them that worship therein. But the court which is without the temple leave out and measure it not, for it is given unto the Gentiles, and to the holy city shall they tread underfoot 42 months. And I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth. These are the two olive trees and the two candlesticks standing before the God of the earth. And if any man will hurt them, fire proceedeth out of their mouth and devoureth their enemies. And if any man will hurt them, he must in this manner be killed. These have the power to shut heaven, that it rain not in the days of their prophecy, and have power over waters to turn them to blood, and to smite the earth with all plagues as often as they will. And when they shall have finished their testimony, the beast that ascendeth out of the bottomless pit shall make war against them, and shall overcome them, and kill them. And their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city, which spiritually is called Sodom and Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified. And many people want to argue about where that is, but notice that third qualifier, where also our Lord was crucified, is Jerusalem. And they of the people and kindreds and tongues and nations shall see their dead bodies 3 days and a half, and shall not suffer their dead bodies to be put in graves. And they that dwell upon the earth shall rejoice over them and make merry, and shall send gifts to one another, because these two prophets tormented them that dwelt on the earth. And after 3 days and a half, the Spirit of life from God entered into them, and they stood upon their feet, and great fear fell upon them which saw them. And they heard a great voice from heaven saying unto them, Come up hither. And they ascended up to heaven in a cloud, and their enemies beheld them. And the same hour was there a great earthquake, and a tenth part of the city fell. And in the earthquake were slain of men 7,000, and the remnant were affrighted and gave glory to the God of heaven. Amen. Yeah, I don't expect they're going to be trifled with much there, Mr. Tater. Where'd Mills go? Oh, kids, okay. Mills, take care. Hope you come back. You're welcome, Pam. Like I said, that's what this is for, is you guys. And you know, I'm interested in all of it. And, you know, if we talk about the things that interest y'all, then it's a lot easier to retain them. And so, like I said, I'm happy to be here, happy to be with you guys. We haven't said a prayer. We need to do that. We have 16 people watching. And generally, I like to wait till we have 10. But tonight, you guys got me kind of wound up. And we're making up for a lot of lost time. But let's bow our hearts and give the word a Lord. Thank you, John. See, I don't pay much attention, and that's what you're for. Thank you so much. Anyway, let's offer the word a word of thanks, and then we'll carry on. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. May your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Please forgive us our sins as we forgive those that sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Father, we love you. We're in love with Christ and all that he's done for us. Father, we're grateful for this Sabbath day and this time to fellowship with our beloved friends and share your word and your gospel truth to this failing world. Father, we love you. We're so appreciative. Thank you for bringing us together. We beg for your spirit to be with us and on each of us and guide us as we study your word, Father. And in Yeshua's beautiful, precious name we pray. Thank you so much. Amen. Okay, guys. And yeah, thanks, John. Like I said, I never really pay attention to my clothing, and I didn't catch it the last time. You know, we discussed the collar issue, but thank you so much. Yep, it's another wonderful Sabbath. Hey, Gear, glad to see you, buddy. Another wonderful Sabbath, and it's just awesome. You know, some of us were talking in the chat room how awesome God is, and you know, they just don't make words to cover that. But yeah, it's sufficient to say God is awesome, that's why we're here. Amen. And good to see you, John. I've been wondering about you. I know you've been busy, and so I hope that we would see you. Oh, John, you didn't get to see Tater. Tater's here in studio with us tonight, and he's answering your questions. You can't see it. He's got his keyboard right here. His controller, so he can answer you from right here. And he can do other things like, and thank you, John. He can do other things like stick his tongue out and stuff, so y'all don't get him too excited. Okay, guys, well, what do we want to elaborate? Like I said, I don't really know what else to be said about the two witnesses. Hello, Namos. Good to see you, sweetie. Oh, and Namo, you didn't get to see either. You just came in. Namo, here's Tater. He's with us today in the studio. I wonder if he can blow the shofar. Tater, can you blow the shofar? Oh, the shofar's getting away. Here we go. Yeah, they, well, you know, it just said there, I can't remember what verse, let me go back to it there, Miss Chandra. But yeah, it says that, you know, they have power over waters, and of course it does specifically mention rain. But you know, guys, you know in a typical way throughout the Bible, most of the time or many times, rain represents blessings. You know, I tell you something interesting, is it one of the holy days where they read the book of Ruth? My wife and I did that, and the interesting thing is there's a blessing promised for this obedience, and we read the book of Ruth one day, and then a gentle rain started. It was really nice. Yes, Namo, that's he sleeps in the mailbox. Yeah. I wondered where the crumbs came from there, Tater. Yes, Chandra, I'm sorry. Verse 6, it says, these have the power to shut heaven, that it rain not in the days of their prophecy, and have power over waters to turn them to blood and smite the earth with all plagues as often as they will. John, I promised him there would be no straws. Uh-oh. Cue the Jaws music. Womp, 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 womp. Hey, MJJ, it's good to see you. Yeah, we got Tater in the studio. John, we need the Mr. Bill voice. You know, no. That's Miss JJ, that's Tater. He's in the studio with us tonight. See, he can't talk because, as you know, Taters don't have a larynx, but he does have his keyboard there, and so any questions you have, he can answer. I've got some, John. Yeah, I've been sick, Namo. I don't really have my voice back, sweetie. I'm sorry. I hope you guys, I hope it's not too hard on y'all. I'm drinking this hot coffee. Maybe it'll help keep my larynx lubed. Hey, John, I wonder if Tater can operate a flooring stapler. That'd be funny. And while we're sitting, I want to see if the Epistle of Barnabas is in this Defender Bible. I don't think it is. Chewed on a cactus. That's it. Hey, there's Breeze. I sure do love that gal. Even she's mean. Y'all don't let me miss anyone, too, because I'm bad to miss stuff in chat, and I always feel bad if someone speaks and I don't respond to them. You know, guys, there's something I need to check in Daniel in the Septuagint. You know, the Septuagint was translated from the Hebrew to Greek by 70 Hebrew or Jewish scholars. And I just discovered the other day that when they translated it, they used the word the Christ in Daniel. And I find that very interesting. And I'm going to look in our Septuagint here and see what it says. But it has been translated from Greek into English. So, you know, I don't know, but I found that to be very, very interesting that they used the Christ in 300 B.C. when she says potato tops, Tater, she's talking about sweet potato leaves. You guys that like vegetables, she cooks the leaves and vines from sweet potatoes, and they're quite delicious. They've got a good taste and a good texture. They're very high in iron, really good for you. And if you guys have access to them, don't miss out trying them. Potato leaves, they're quite good. And sweetheart, her name is Namo. But if you look at, read it backwards, it says it's a woman. Yeah, John, like I said, they're really good. They're surprisingly good. If you like something like turnip greens and things like that, you'll be astonished. Sweet potato tops are really good. And like I said, they've got a nice flavor. And they've got the best texture of any boiled greens to me because, you know, turnip greens, they just, you know, like spinach or something, they're just kind of mushy. But potato vines, they're good.
They're good. Let's see. I was looking for... Yeah, it's not here. Just kind of didn't expect it to be.
Yeah, Chandra, she cooks a lot of squash blossoms and she eats weeds and stuff. In the Philippines, they all kind of greens and stuff that the people eat over there. And here, They're widely ignored. My uncle really got a kick out of it. One year he invited her to come and get turnip greens from his garden. And he and I walked out there with her to get her turnip greens, and she just went bananas over some kind of weed that was growing out there. And he just laughed and laughed. But she got as much weed as she got turnip greens. But she really loves her. She's a rabbit. And hey, Scott, it's good to see you, buddy. And yeah, I saw JIB at the TNS today, and I didn't see him here. Oh, there he is. Hey, JB, good to see you. Thanks for coming. And I kind of hate to get. let me look here while we're going on. You guys tell me what you want to talk about, and we'll go there. Like I said, I'm trying to find the passage in Daniel. I'm going to think it's around 27, but and then I'll look in the Septuagint. I say 27, I meant 9:27, of course. Yeah, here in the King James it says, until Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks and 3 score 2 weeks. Let's look in the Septuagint. Oh, we're delighted to have you, JB, and invite anyone and everyone that you know. If they've got a heart for Christ or they want to know Christ or what the Bible says, we'd be delighted to have them here. Let's get the Septuagint down. I've got it kind of wedged in here. Oops, get up there, Barnabas. Excuse all the crawling around, guys. Let's see, Mr. Daniel. This is one of those bright white papered books, and it's already starting to turn yellow around the edges. I like the book, though. Not complaining. Yeah, this reads a little different. Like I said, this has been translated from the Greek to English. So it's I couldn't read it if it was in Greek anyway. I'll read from chapter 9, the book of Daniel, in the Septuagint, from chapter 25. And thou shalt know and understand that from the going forth of the command for the answer and for the building of Jerusalem, there it is, until Christ the Prince. Amen. Awesome. There shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks, and then the time shall return, and the street shall be built, and the wall, and the time shall be exhausted. And after the 62 weeks, the anointed one shall be destroyed, and there is no judgment in him, and he shall destroy the city and the sanctuary with the prince that is coming. They shall be cut off with a flood, and to the end of the war, which is rapidly completed, he shall appoint the city to desolations. And 1 week shall establish the covenant with many, and in the midst of the week my sacrifice and drink offering shall be taken away, and on the temple shall be the abomination of desolations, and at the end of time an end shall be put to the desolation. But yeah, that's really cool. So chapter 9, verse 25, if you have access to a Septuagint, it says, and thou shalt know and understand that from the going forth of the command for the answer and for the building of Jerusalem until Christ the Prince, there shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. That's amazing because, like I said, this was translated from the Hebrew to the common Greek in 300 B.C. 300 B.C., a few days before Christ got here. That's really awesome. Hey, Susan, and who else have I missed? I see Betty. Who is Betty? Hello, Betty. Awesome, Susan. okay, Jib, JB is Betty. All right, awesome. Yeah, and that's great, Susan. And Susan, I hope you told them about our gathering here and invited them. We'd be loving to have them and hopefully help them as they progress. Susan, those of you that are late coming, we do have a guest in the studio this evening, and it is our very own Bricap Tater. And here he is. He's standing on the table. He's got his little keyboard here. And so he's able to join in all the conversations and stay right up with everybody. You guys thank him for all of his trouble. He mailed himself. He was in a box for 3 days with a turkey sandwich, and he had a hard time, but he got used to sleeping in the mailbox. So at any rate, let me put this away. Thank you, Susan. Yeah, Tater, he does. He's kind of short, isn't he? But you guys, did you guys get the gist of what I was saying? That the Hebrew, the Jewish writers or translators of the Septuagint, and this would have been the Bible that Christ was familiar with. It was translated in 300 BC, and it was in wide use during his time, during his days, and. I think that's really awesome that they're right there in Daniel 9:25, the Christ. Really, really awesome. Thank you, John. Like I said, we're gonna make a few more minor changes from where we're at, John. I'm gonna move some things in this room. I've got a big desk in here that's really become obsolete. That's where I used to, where we started doing the show from, was at that desk, and it's over in the corner. I'm gonna move it and some other things out, and actually, I'm gonna bring a sofa or a futon in here. But we're gonna make some more changes. Make a little bit more room and probably move the cameras back just a little bit to give us a better view, but we're going to experiment a little bit and see how it goes. Anyway, and I did I broke all my glasses, guys. I got on a new pair today that we went to town and bought glasses. So we're adjusting to a lot of stuff. And hey, Christine, I have to keep changing the camera to show everybody else. Tater is in studio with us tonight, Christine. He's right in front of me. Right there he is on the table. And he's got a keyboard there, and so that's how he's communicating with you this evening. Thank you, Betty. Hey, Farva. How you doing, buddy? It's good to see you. Hi, hello all there, done. That's the good way, isn't it? Okay, guys, well... We're 31 minutes in, guys. That means we got a whole hour and a half if my voice lasts that long. And like I said, this is y'all's time. I enjoy to spend it with you and be here with you. And we're going to talk about whatever you want to talk about. Dave, while I'm thinking about it, don't let me forget, you asked me to add one name to the prayer list. And
It's Newf, and I'm pretty sure you said it was Wayne. Is that correct?
I hope so. I hope I've got that right. I did add Wayne.
You know, that's it's not really off topic, Chandra. It's just kind of contentious. Just about anything I say, somebody's going to get mad at me because they have a differing opinion. But I hate when that happens, Sarah. I've done that before. Amy, one moment, sweetie. You know what I think I'm going to do with our prayer list, whenever we change it or rotate it out, I think I'm going to, I'm saving the old list, and I'll be happy to mail it to any of you prayer warriors that would like to continue to pray for these people, and y'all could even pass them around as far as that goes. The first temple was built sometime before, but it was destroyed in 587 BC, and then the second one had been under construction for 43 years when Christ told the disciples, I'd tear this temple down in 3 days, build it back, and it took another 3 years to be completed from there. So kicking back 43 years, about 10 years before his birth, I guess, would have been the start of it. And then, of course, it was destroyed on 70 AD. Both temples were destroyed on the month of Av, the ninth day of the month of Av. And the first temple, 587 BC, and the second one, maybe 586, but I think it's 587. And then the second one, 70 AD. Well, yeah, John, you mentioned that, and I promise you, I failed to study on it. There is a study that explains it, and I just can't remember the gist of it. And I apologize. I meant to look into that. What I wanted to say about that, something in the text tends to mislead our modern mind about. I can't remember exactly. It may be the origins of the children, I promise I'll look into that because I'm glad you brought it up, but I just basically forgot, I need to study up on it again before I say too much. I don't want to get it wrong, but like I said, I think there's something in that story that tends to kick our modern mind off into another direction. But if you'll bear with me a couple of days, try to remind me again, please, after sometime when we're just talking, because it's so easy for me to forget all this stuff. Sometimes I make notes, and I can write it down, but in here it's not going to help that much. But if you'll try to help me remember, I'll get to the bottom of it for you. I meant to do that the other day when we talked, and I'm sorry that I did not. Those are pretty good questions, Sarah. Let me just look. I tell you what, probably easiest would be look at something like Wikipedia. It's probably give us the dates quickest. First temple was Solomon's. Solomon's temple. Let's see what it says here. Wikipedia, the greatest source of information. No, I'm just kidding, but I will use it sometime for expediency. According to the Hebrew Bible, Solomon's temple, also known as the first temple, was the holy temple in ancient Jerusalem before its destruction by Nebuchadnezzar after the siege of Jerusalem of 587 BCE and its subsequent replacement with the second temple in the 6th century BCE. The Hebrew Bible states that the temple was constructed under Solomon, King, United Kingdom of Israel and Judah. The Jewish historian Josephus says that the temple was burnt 470 years, 6 months, and 10 days after it was built. That's pretty... Josephus nails it down there pretty close. 470 years, 6 months, and 10 days after it was built. Although the rabbinic sources state that the first temple stood for 410 years. Based on the 2nd century work, Seder Olam Rabbah, placed construction in 832 BCE and destruction in 422 BCE, 165 years later than secular estimates. Anyway, okay. Did that cover much of it, or what you wanted to know? Yeah, if you'll notice the words they use, the Dome of the Rock. You know, they have two buildings there. They have the Dome of the Rock, and then they have the Al-Aqsa Mosque. And of course, the mosque is like a church or a teaching place or whatever. But the Dome of the Rock is over a rock that's exposed from the ground, and they claim that that's where Muhammad left Earth to go to heaven or some crap. I'm not sure, but anyway, I'm pretty sure that their patriarchs probably knew of its holiness from the Jewish God, and anyway, found that spot and go, oh yeah, here's a good rock. And that was built in the year of like around 600 or 6th century AD, if I'm not mistaken. But anyway. How many years did the second temple stand? It would have had to have been, let's see, Ladybug, let's just take a couple of assumptions and we'll get pretty close. Let's say that Yeshua was crucified in 30 AD and that the temple was 43 years old at that time. And we know that it was destroyed in 70 AD, which would be 40 more years. So roughly 86 years, something like that, or maybe 100 years in that time frame. Does that help? Sure, Pam, you're welcome. Well, Boost, you know, we don't want to be mean to them, because remember something I hope you know many of you heard today, that we're commanded to love one another because we're all images of God. You know, each of us is like an image or a photograph of God, and that's why we're not to attack one another. We're to love one another, and keep bear in mind that the Muslims are very much like any of us. You know, there but for the grace of God go I. Here we have people that are reaching for God, and they love God in a very faithful, even fanatical way. They've just been deceived by the demon, and we need to pity them, we need to pray for them, and when we have a real opportunity, we need to reach out to them. Even Muhammad said that Christ was the Messiah, but it gets glossed over in their teachings. So, like I said, pity them, pray for them. God's making a mighty move throughout the Muslim world. I'm sure that there are millions of good-hearted, loving people there, and that I pray that we meet many of them in heaven. Yeah, they're wrong. They certainly are. Islam is counterfeit Christianity. You know, you've never seen a counterfeit $4 bill, because there's not a real $4 bill. Only the genuine is counterfeited. And if you'll notice that Islam is definitely counterfeit Christianity, it goes back to the sons of Abraham. Abraham, he tried to take things into his own hand, and he procreated a child with his wife's handmaid, Hagar. But this was not the child of promise. God said, Sarah will bear a child. And, you know, they didn't believe him because they were so old. But we all know better than to take God lightly. And Sarah did produce the child of promise, which was Isaac. But the Muslims say that since Ishmael was the firstborn, that he's the child of promise. But that's just simply not the case. You know, if you look,
we can take another picture from Jacob and Esau. Jacob was the second born, not the firstborn. They were twins, but Esau was the firstborn, and turns out who was the child of promise. So anyway, we pity those, love them like we love everyone, and pray for them. You know, they're just as valuable to God as anyone we know, and we need to bear that in mind. It's not always easy, but being loving in this world is not. Yep, and yeah, absolutely, Samantha. Yeah, you can post. Right. Yep. Yeah. I forgot about the meteorite, but yeah. You guys. You can post anything you want here as long as it's not offensive, and I don't think any of you guys will. Yep, they certainly will, Tater. Well, they believe in him now, but they don't realize that he's the king. You know, they think he's going to assist Muhammad or some polywog, you know, craziness. Anyway, but Sarah said something that I wanted to address too. Yeah, fighting over the inheritance. You know, I find it very, very interesting. Let's look. It's in Genesis. Let's see if I can find it, rather. Sorry, guys. I get to reading there, and anyway, what I was going on about, I didn't find it, Sarah, but you're talking about finding of the inheritance. I find it very, very interesting that if you find the passage in the Bible where Jacob told his father, he said, "It's me, Esau, your firstborn." He deceived his father. And then just a few chapters later, Jacob finds himself wrestling with God, and he says, "I won't let you go until you bless me." And God says a very curious thing. He says, "What is your name?" And like I said, I think it's just awesome, because you think about it. Jacob had lied to his father. And here he was wrestling with the father. And he said, "Okay, what's your name? Am I blessing Jacob or Esau?" And anyway, like I said, it's just God's awesome. But anyway. All right, let's see what I'm missing here. Yeah, Boost, this is true that, you know, we do have a lot of pastors out there that they're preaching a feel-good gospel. And, you know, of course, the gospel is a feel-good gospel, especially if you know and understand and believe. But yeah, I feel for them, and you know, bear in mind, look at what the scripture says. You know, if the watchman sees the enemy and he doesn't blow the trumpet, then you know, those that perish because they weren't warned, you know, their blood is required at his hand. And I have to pity those pastors that seem to not know better either. I don't understand. I see many that they're strong on preaching
certain parts of the Bible as if they like certain parts of it and they don't approve of other parts. But, you know, the Bible is, it can't be taken apart. It is a whole. And either you believe it or you don't. And it's something that has to be understood and taught. You know, you guys heard me say it before, and I think Breeze was there, one of the local pastors. He was excited, and he told me, "Yeah, I'm gonna do a series on the seven ways to avoid cancer." And I said, "Brother, you need to forget cancer and preach on the seven ways to avoid hell, because hell's coming for all, and not cancer." The church has become soft, and they don't want to teach what the Bible says because it's not politically correct. But unfortunately, God's not coming to lead up a democracy. He's coming to lead a monarchy, and He is the King. Amen. That's right, Booster. Yep. And you know, it's a shame because, you know, don't get me wrong, whoever this falls on, you're not alone. We all do it. And in our hearts and minds, we sometimes become somewhat arrogant because we have Christ. And of course, I think most of us realize the error in that way, but you know, what we want to do is make the right impression. You guys remember what Gandhi said after he came and visited. He said, "You know, I like your Christ very much. I do not like your Christians. Well, they are so different from your Christ." We need to set the proper example and do the best we can. Time's short, guys. Time's really short. And we just have to... Hey, Miss Appleseed, how you doing? Well, certainly, you know, healthy way. I'm not saying to ignore health, Breeze, but, you know, church is not here to teach us how to have a proper diet. Now, that can be a good byproduct, but church is here to teach us about our relationship with our Creator. And what He says is exercise profiteth the body, but very little. Exercise your spirit, and there's where your real treasure is going to be. At any rate, where are we at? Yeah, you're right, Chandra. It absolutely was an indictment on most all Christians because, you know, like I said, it's really unfortunate. That's the way the world views many of us, is because this is the way that so many of us conduct ourselves. It's just a shame. It really is. I can't remember the joke now, but you know, it's something about Baptists never recognize one another at the liquor store. Like I said, I butchered it, but anyway, there's some truth there. Oh man, I'm so sorry to hear that, Miss Appleseed. Yeah. Let's put her on the prayer list, and we'd love to teach her, Miss Appleseed, if she'd like to come around. I can give her plenty of evidence that and that's something you need to tell her about. Even Muhammad said that Christ was the Messiah. Muhammad didn't have any power to perform any miracles. He never did anything like that. He'd never made any prophecies. He's just not the man. And Christ is, and you know that. And we hopefully she's just been lured in. You know that they teach a lot of stuff that hooks people. And hopefully we can get her out of those chains of bondage. What's her name, sweetheart? What, a name doesn't have to be her name, but you know, maybe something you call her, something that we can identify her by. Yep, Muhammad's still dead, and I expect he's always going to be. Amen, Boost. Oh, what a beautiful name. You know, that's Rachel's sister's name. Okay. Well, we've got her. I want to say Melissa. Isn't your name Melissa? I want to call you Melissa. I hope that's not wrong, but it's a little shorter than Appleseed. Well, I giggled a little bit about Ivan today and told him I need to look up the passage where Yeshua, Jesus, called James and John sons of thunder for their short temper. And Brother Boost and Brother Ivan remind me of this very much. And it's not a bad thing, but they love Jesus and they're quite defensive of the gospel, and we love them too as well. But Boost and Ivan are, in my mind, sons of thunder. I don't know much about the history of Star of David, Sarah. I think I did. I showed you guys the very interesting little thing about. Let me reach up and get a marker. A very interesting little thing, and I'll try to do it over here on the whiteboard. Yeah, I was catching up here on the chat. A very interesting thing about that, Star of David, Sarah. Like I said, I'm not really sure about its origins, but let's consider a couple of things. You remember in the scripture in Exodus, he talks about the Passover, and the Israelites were to strike the doorpost with the blood of the lamb. On these three places. And this, as we know, this ritual performed on Passover, it's an act of man reaching up to God. And if you'll notice, you take and connect these with a line, you get a triangle pointing upward, man reaching up to God. And then if we take, I'm going to draw it right here in the background. Not much of an artist. I'm trying not to mess up the markers too badly. Anyway, we take the cross, and we know that Christ was crucified, and his blood was here, here, and here. And this is an act of God reaching down to man. And lo and behold, look what happens. If we connect those by the same lines, what do we get? Amazing, huh? Anyway, when God reached down to man, we get this triangle, and like I said, it's pretty interesting. Catch is going. Where are you going there, brother? Amen, Mills. Boger knees. is it? Yeah, Boger Knees. Hey, Paul. Good to see you, buddy. Oh, well, Boost, let's try not to be so divisive, if you will. I mean, it's okay for you to believe, you know, what you want within your interpretation of what it says. But, you know, as humans, we're all prone to being wrong. I certainly myself included. We're prone to being wrong from time to time, and oftentimes it's in a way that instructs us in humility. But personally, I do not believe that every unrepentant human will suffer torment forever. And we can discuss that at some point. But that's not really my point. It's like I said, it's okay for you to disagree with me. I don't have any problem with that. But let's not divide the group, especially over a belief that we hold to ourselves. It's just not worth it, brother. You understand. You know, like I said, I kind of tend to side with Catch a little bit on that. You know, one of the reasons I believe that, Boost, is if we throw a piece of wood in the fire, it burns up and is gone. Now, we know that the lake of fire was created for the fallen angels. And they're not physical beings, they're spirit beings. And so I expect they will be tormented forever because they're not built for death. But humans, I think, are different. I think that when they're burned up, they will be gone. I don't know, but I lean towards that way. And like I said, I certainly don't want to upset my brothers or sisters with something I may or may not believe, and I hope you feel the same way. God is the judge, and let's pretty much leave it to Him. We can study what it says and settle it in our own mind in our own way, which is okay. God wants you to ponder His word, but let's not let it be a point of contention among the brethren. Okay, guys. Well, we're only 1 hour in. Okay. Chandra, I did not know that. Thank you. That's pretty cool. Didn't know that. I've always liked that. I've actually used Son of Thunder in a Yahoo format of some sort. I think I've heard Boger Knees, but I did not know that that's what it meant, and that's really cool. Yeah, we love you, Boost, of course we love Dave too, we want to keep our family with us. Thank you very much, Paul. I'm not feeling a great deal better, but I'm here. You can tell that I can't hardly talk good, and boy, it's kind of painful back there, but that's not much. You're wondering where the stars were at when Yeshua was born. I don't understand what you mean, Sarah. You do know that the heavenly host, the angels, are represented by stars, and there may be a physical star for each angel. That's something I'm not really clear on, but you mean like the star chart behind us? Sarah, you what you need is a program. I've got it on several of the machines around here. It's an astronomy program, and it's not going to be perfect, but it's really good, and I use it with my telescope for finding things and things of that nature. Stellarium. I'll type it in here so you know. But it's free. You can download it. You'll really like it, and you can run the clock back. You can go back to, if you determine whatever year. I don't know. I don't think it'll go to BC, but you can go back to probably year one.
anyway, you can see the position of the heavens on that particular day at any time of the day. It's really, really cool. Let me post it. Stellarium. It's free. Pretty cool. Try it out. You'll like it. Yeah, Starry Night. I've got Starry Night, Pam. I haven't used it, but I understand it's pretty good. Man, I got so much software and stuff laying around. I can open Stellarium and see, Millie. Yeah, you can download it free, and of course it gets better. And I love things like that that can be used to for like our Bible study. You know, if you want to know where the positions of the planets were on a particular date in history, all you got to do is punch it in there, and it's really awesome. We're very, very lucky. Thank you, Ivan. We're very, very lucky that the time that we live in, I mean, you guys, many of you that are my age or older, remember card catalogs and things like that. You know, it could take all day to find one bit of information that that now we can get in a ridiculously quick amount of time. And and it applies to scriptural studies as well. And we're just truly blessed to the max about what we have available to us. And like I said, it's just awesome. I mean, you know, if you can't find a particular scripture, if you can remember part of it, go type it in a search engine. You'll get a return. And you know, that's just things of fantasy when I was a child. So it's really cool. Yeah, the neat thing about Mars is without a good scope, it's hard to follow because it tracks across the sky so quickly. We watched it one year on a 50-millimeter small scope, and you'd have to reposition the scope about every 20 or 30 seconds. It's just ridiculous. You could just watch it go across the field of view. Of course, with the big scope and the motor drive, I can kind of fix on it, but it's cool. Genesis 1:14, well, I'd say it's extremely applicable, Tater. Let me go to that particular verse. It's talking about the lights in the sky, but I don't want to mess it up when I read it. And God said, "Let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for season and for days and years." But you know, unfortunately, we don't read that in the original language. In the original language, it didn't say signs and seasons. It said Oat and Moed. And that's we've talked about that, divine assemblies and special times, so it applied from then on. You know, he said, "I'm going to use these for signs and signals and to establish these Oat and Moed and divine assemblies and like dress rehearsal." But that's the feast days, and it's really cool. I don't. What do you mean, Raven? does what have a deeper meaning? Oh, wait a minute! I'm missing something here. Let me scroll back just a little bit, guys. Y'all get ahead of me when I'm not looking at the chat. Wow, Raven, I need to take that in. I need to read a little bit around that. Hold on, I'll try to get to you there. I need a little bit more context around that verse to comment on it. And let's see. Okay, I think just mostly you guys talking amongst yourselves. I thought I'd missed something. Let's see. Raven was talking about Isaiah chapter 41, I think is what you said. Is that correct, Raven? Let me scroll back to where Mr. Ravenwood posted his verse. Yeah, 41:1. Okay. Yeah, it's basically God helping Israel, Raven, reading verse a couple of verses before that. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles, and they shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. Keep silence before me, O islands, and let the people renew their strength. Let them come near, then let them speak. Let us come near together to judgment. Who raised up the righteous man from the east, called him to his foot, and gave the nations before him, and made him rule over kings? He gave them as dust to his sword, and as driven stubble to his bow. He pursued them and passed safely, even by the way that he had not gone with his feet. Who hath wrought and done it, calling the generations from the beginning? I, the Lord, the first and the last, I am He. It's God helping Israel, Raven, and you know, practically everything in the Bible has a meaning beyond the surface text. I think the rabbis call it the sod level or something like that. I think it's like a secondary meaning within the text. Many of it is hard to derive without understanding the Hebrew mindset, and you know, I certainly don't always. I've been instructed in some of the passages, but yeah, there's a lot of really deep stuff there that a lot of it's concealed from me because of my lack of knowledge of the old language, there's just really a lot there. So I would have to say, yes, probably a deeper meaning. What it is, I wouldn't be able to roll it off confidently. Well, Mills, if we look, there's several places where it's mentioned, The Gentiles and the Jews, when the Gentiles are mentioned as olives, they're the wild olives that are grafted in. Okay, Raven, gotcha. My brain's jumping around here. Let me go back and read your question again. Which passage are you drawing from, Mills? Revelation or somewhere else? Right, that's why I'm asking you which passage. You know, typically the symbology is going to carry over, but I'm interested in which passage that you're drawing from. Okay, yeah, I'm not sure about the conversation here. If you look at the candles or lampstands in the early verses of Revelation, Mills, of course, you know, chapter 1, verse 20,
He says, the mystery of the seven stars, which you didn't ask about seven stars, but says, which the mystery of the seven stars, which thou sawest in my right hand, and the seven golden candlesticks, the seven stars, the angels of the angels of the seven churches, and the seven candlesticks, which thou saw, are the seven churches. I need to find, there's another passage that I think would help us if I can find it. You know, I'm looking at here, Mills, the two olive trees. You know, that would almost, to me, suggest that they're both Jewish. And the two lampstands, I don't know, sweetie. That's, you know, something I'll have to look into a little bit further on that particular terminology. Or the usage of it there. John. Paul, you got it, brother, but you're not alone. You know, the devil's after everybody, and I think he thinks it a special treat when he steals one of Christ's. We'll pray for you, brother. Hey, Patty, good to see you. And those of you that are just coming in, anybody that hasn't seen, we have Tater in the studio with us tonight, and there he is. He's faithfully at his keyboard typing away. He's shy. He won't move while you guys are looking at him. But anyway, yeah, Tater's here, and we're happy to have him. And he's typing to you direct from the tabletop. Well, I'm here, Patty. Like I said, my voice is shot and all that stuff, but we're struggling through. Chandra, what about Ezekiel 38? I think it's soon to happen. Could be wrong, but I think it's soon to happen. Sure looks that way anyway, doesn't it? I think we've got you on the, I'm pretty sure we got you on, we got you right up near the top, you and Rose both, Paul. And so we'll keep you there and keep yelling your name. Monkey on a football. Well, I don't really understand what you're saying there, Chandra. Like I said, I'll read over it right quick. And the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, this is Ezekiel chapter 38. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, set thy face against Gog, the land of Magog, the chief prince of Meshech and Tubal, and prophesy against him. And you, I think it was you I was talking to the other day. If you look back in Genesis 10 at the sons of Japheth, you'll see that many of these are mentioned. And these are the men that settled the area that we would commonly call Russia today. Chief prince of Meshach and Tubal, and prophesy against him, and say, Thus saith the Lord God, Behold, I am against thee, O Gog, the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal, and I will turn thee back and put hooks into thy jaws, and I will bring thee forth, and I'll bring thee forth, and all thine army, horses and horsemen, all of them clothed with all sorts of armor, even a great company with bucklers and shields, all of them handling swords. Persia, Ethiopia, and Libya with them, all of them with shield and helmet. Gomer and all his bands, the house of Togarma of the north quarters, and all his bands, and many people with thee. Be thou prepared, and prepare for thyself, thou and all thy company that are assembled unto thee, and be thou a guard unto them. After many days thou shalt be visited. In the latter years thou shalt come into the land that is brought back from the sword and is gathered out of many people, against the mountains of Israel, which have been always waste, but is brought forth out of the nations, and they shall dwell safely, all of them. Let's pause right there for a moment. Think about it. Israel was a barren wasteland until the Israelites were regathered there roughly in the middle of the last century, 1948. Actually, they were gathered before then, but that's when it became a nation. And it has blossomed like a rose in the desert. It's amazing, and it's pretty much what this prophecy talks about. Thou shalt ascend and come like a storm. Thou shalt be like a cloud to cover the land, thou and all thy bands, and many people with thee. Thus saith the Lord God, it shall also come to pass that at the same time shall things come into thy mind, and thou shalt think an evil thought. And thou shalt say, I will go up to the land of unwalled villages. I will go to them that are at rest, that dwell safely, all of them dwelling without walls, and having neither bars nor gates. To take a spoil, and to take a prey, to turn thine hand upon the desolate places that are now inhabited, and upon the people that are gathered out of the nations, which have gotten cattle and goods, and dwell in the midst of the land. Sheba and Dedan, the merchants of Tarshish, with all the young lions thereof, shall say unto thee, Art thou come to take a spoil? Hast thou gathered thy company to take a prey? To carry away silver and gold, to take away cattle and goods, to take a great spoil? Therefore, son of man, prophesy, and say unto Gog, Thus saith the Lord God, In that day when my people of Israel dwelleth safely, shalt thou not know it? And thou shalt come from thy place out of the north parts, thou and many people with thee, all of them riding upon horses, a great company and a mighty army. And thou shalt come up against my people Israel as a cloud to cover the land, and it shall be in the latter days. Check this out. Now, this has got something written on it, but let me point out, Israel is about right here, and look, right straight due north is Moscow. Isn't that amazing? And let's see. All of them riding upon horses, a great company and a mighty army. And thou shalt come up against my people of Israel as a cloud to cover the land. And it shall be in the latter days, and I will bring thee against my land, that the heathen may know me, when I shall be sanctified in thee, O Gog, before their eyes. Thus saith the Lord God, Art thou he of whom I have spoken in old time by my servants, the prophets of Israel, which prophesied in those days many years that I would bring thee against them? And he's asking now, you know, Hey, Putin, are you him? I talked about you many years ago. And then this is a brutal statement. And he says, And it shall come to pass at the same time when Gog shall come against the land of Israel, saith the Lord God, that my fury shall come up in my face. And brother, I don't want no part of that. For in my jealousy and in the fire of my wrath have I spoken. Surely in that day there shall be a great shaking in the land of Israel, so that the fishes of the sea and the fowls of the heaven and the beasts of the field and all creeping things that creep upon the earth and all the men that are upon the face of the earth shall shake at my presence, and the mountains shall be thrown down, and the steep places shall fall, and every wall shall fall to the ground. And I will call for a sword against him throughout all my mountains, saith the Lord God. Every man's sword shall be against his brother. And I will plead against him with pestilence and with blood, and I will rain upon him and upon his bands and upon the many people that are with him an overflowing rain and great hailstones, fire and brimstone. Thus will I magnify myself and sanctify myself, and I will be known in the eyes of many nations, and they shall know that I am the Lord. Amen. And I believe that, like I said, that prophecy is soon to be fulfilled. I could be mistaken. But I think it's soon to be fulfilled. Right, John, you're absolutely right. Leviathan gas field is got more natural gas than Russia ever dreamed about. And it's just crazy what's going on. But it was written, you know, like we've talked before, none of us thought this was going to happen in our lifetimes. But lo and behold, look, it sure is. And It's awesome, and you know, it's just more signs that that God is true, His word is true, and He's keeping His promise. You know, like I said, I think many of us thought that we'd be dust by the time that Christ returned, but I think we were mistaken. And let's see, what did I miss here? Have I missed anything in the chat? Don't hurt yourself jumping off the table there, Tater. I'll get you the ladder. Yep. God is a promise keeper. Amen. Well, if I can stay in this chair for 38 more minutes, we will have made it. Like I said, I know, to me, it's kind of annoying listening to someone talk. Well, that sounds like I do, and I apologize for that, guys. But work with what I got, huh? Play the cards I got. Yeah, Chandra, like I said, that's, you know, we were told about it all of our lives, and or at least I was as a child, and just never expected it. Ooh, Patty, don't you know it? You know, Patty, I've talked to and about some folks that don't believe, and I just, for the life of me, can't understand how they could possibly carry on with the absence of hope that they must have, it's just crazy what's going on these days. I fixed Tater's facial expression for John. Let's see if I, yeah, there we go. Oh, his glasses are a little crooked. There we go. I hope it went well, Samantha, and we're happy to pray for her and anyone that wants to be prayed for. Don't think you got much longer to wait, Sarah. I don't know. I'm just a man, just like you, just watching. But in my heart, in my mind, I'm pretty satisfied. We don't have long to wait. That's right, Boost. Pam, I've done that before, and I wish him far better luck than I had. Well, good, Samantha, and as we know that Yeshua can use that eye doctor like I would a Q-tip or something, and he can fix it, so we'll continue to pray for her. We do have her name on the list, I hope. Yes, Tater. Okay, everyone, see this video right now. I'm not sure what it's about, but if John says it's important, it probably is. I'm checking it now, John.
Okay, and that's just cruel. I'm out of cola. Okay, Tater. Tater, don't watch the video. It'll just simply be upsetting. I bet John's having French fries for dinner. Where did Breeze go? She hadn't said a word in a while. She may have left us. She probably got mad at me. She'll beat me later. And I'm not going to fry this one, John. He'll just get all melty. Now, Tater's safely here on the table, Boost, so that must have been family or something. He probably knows who it was from the bumps in their head. If he's not too upset, maybe he'll tell you. I just don't know. And here, he'll give John the signal again. And too bad his little hand won't do. Oh, wait a minute, his other hand's lost in the white over here. I bet you can't do this, John. He's marching with my cigar. Okay. Tater's smoking, huh? Oh my goodness. Yeah, that's a 30 caliber cigar. Matthew chapter 12, 25. Let me check and see what Raven's on about here. Yeah, it's all relevant, Raven. You can bet on that, brother. Chapter 24 is very, very relevant to our day if you're reading in Matthew. But let me go to 12 and see what we got sorted out there. You said 12 and 25. 12 and 25. Yeah, Jesus knew their thoughts and said unto them, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and every city or house divided against itself shall not stand. And he was answering a question there. He says, if Satan casts out Satan, he's divided against himself. How shall then his kingdom stand? And if you read the verse just before 25:24. It says, when the Pharisees heard it, they said, this fellow does not cast out devils, but by Beelzebub, the prince of the devils. They were accusing Christ of only being able to cast out devils because he was a devil. And he was answering them saying, you know, no, the devil, if he casts himself out, he's divided against himself. And as you well know, the house divided cannot stand. Potato Coastal. That's pretty cute. Susan, personally, I think that we'll know because we won't be. But I'm pretty sure it's not going to be a situation where people are going to go, I wonder if that's the ones they're talking about. But those are the ones.
you know, God, he's not going to do something halfway, and he's we've gotten to the end, and he's now is when the punchline comes. He's making the point, and I don't think that there's going to be any question about many of these things. People are like, well, how are we going to know this or that? I think it's going to be really plain. Somebody asked me something. I can't remember what it was, but it was a similar question, you know. And he says, well, you know, how are we going to know what happens? And I said, you're not going to have to ask me. And like I said, you know, it was just like Ezekiel 38. You know, he said, my fury shall come up in my face, and I'll be sanctified, you know, in you, O Gog. In other words, you know, you're going to be the example. Like I said, I don't think we'll be here, Susan, but anyone that is, I don't think that they're going to have a big question about it. All right, guys, well, less than a half hour left. Y'all talk to me. What do you want? I keep trying to figure out how to do a good Bible trivia contest where we can have an actual clear winner and give away some little prizes of some sort. Like I said, it's not going to be anything great, but at any rate, if anybody's got any good ideas about that, and it may be something that we can do that we don't have to do during the study group, like, you know, via email or something, but we'll figure it out and do something. Yeah, Susan, I've thought about that. And hey, Natalie, thank you. I've thought about that, Susan. And, you know, there's going to be some jaws on the ground, buddy. But the wonderful thing about it is we've all been studying and reading, and we're prepared. We know what's going to happen. And I'm sure it's going to be surprising, but I don't think it's going to take us by surprise. And like I said, the rest of the world, they're going to have dirt on their chin. Because, yeah, you're right. I can imagine the look on the world's face just after the bride's taken. Varangian guard. Now, Raven, no, not right off the bat. I mean, nothing, it doesn't ring a bell. I'll be happy to hear. Yeah, you know, Miss Johnson, and I don't know how long we've been doing this now, a little over a year. But for the last couple of years, I've been seeing a great deal of interest in the prophecies and stuff. And it's because people are waking up and they know where we are on the Lord's calendar. And it's coming, and Natalie's absolutely 100% perfectly right. She says many will still not believe what they will see, and this is true. And it's very sad, you know. That's aliens, or, you know, whatever kind of crap story they want to believe. That's what they're going to believe, and it's sad. But, you know, for those of us that know the truth, love the truth, and love the Lord, we get to get out of here. And, praise the Lord. Yeah. Well, you know, guys, you think about it. You read the scriptures carefully. After the 1,000 years, Satan's turned loose again to deceive men. And even then, people will be deceived. And that just speaks to the hard-heartedness and the arrogance of man. And I know you guys have seen it. You meet somebody that's pretty intelligent, and they're too smart for God. But that just tells you, you know, how really smart they are. But the world, we have a duty to reach out to them and love as many into the fold as we can. It's difficult, and it's getting more difficult. I highly recommend each of you pray for the opportunity to share your testimony and share Christ with an eager, willing ear. And God knows where they are, and He'll send one your way. And it's a great blessing. But I reckon every one of you should pray for an opportunity to share the gospel. And And in so doing, hasten the Lord's coming, because we're all ready to go. Amen. Amen, Natalie. Tater like sodas. And yeah, I noticed, hopefully the microphone hasn't cut out any tonight. We did get the little adapter we needed, a tiny, tiny little part that was making all that trouble. Yeah, Miss Johnson, you know, that I think many of us feel that way, and I've been that way a long time. I don't know if any of you have lost someone close to you, but when they go through the natural process, I had a doctor explain it to me that many of them go through terminal agitation. You know, it's as if they know they're going somewhere, and they're ready to get on with it, but they don't know where to go, and it's because they're not going in their physical form. It's really something to see, and I feel that way myself in these days, and I think it's because it's time. Hey, Ken, good to see you, brother. Amen, Natalie. We have a duty. And hey, Christine, good to see you, sweetie. Gilbert. My wife hates it. So if I'm live tomorrow, I'll probably be without the beard. She hates it. And me, I can go either way. I don't mind not shaving, but it does get a little itchy and stuff. So, you know, I can go either way. I hate it when I get old. I'm dreading my beard turning gray. It's blonde now. Yeah, it's time, Favre. Well, like I said, John, I don't mind. I like it, but Breeze, boy, she's been after me for days. Shave it. Yeah, I found some of it, Sarah. Ha ha. Yeah, this is so fair. You can see me and pick on me. I have no idea. You could be wearing a potato can of, I don't know. Oh, my goodness. Yeah, I'm just kidding. My beard's white. I see, Raven. Okay. It's really interesting. You know, our secular human history has some really amazing things when it comes to God's people, you know, we can only attribute that to the sovereignty of God, and you know, he said he would do this, and he has, and is, and you know, it's as we've all discussed, it's really amazing. But yeah, throughout the timeline of human beings on the planet, he's done some incredible things, and yeah, it's very interesting. What I really can't wait for is when we get to heaven and he shows us the big picture, the whole movie. So we'll see and know what happened and when and why, and that's going to be really gratifying. at any rate, yeah, it's very interesting, Raven, and I'll try to remember to check it out. Thank you, Sarah. You know, that's funny, Susan. I don't guess I've ever seen Bill. Maybe I've seen him in one of your pictures before, but for some reason I was thinking that I had it in my mind, or the image of Bill, or the legend, was no beard. If you have questions for me, Sarah, by all means, just throw them out there. That's what we're here for. Steven says, my cancer is in total remission. I have checkups every 6 months for the next 5 years. My wife's mother has cancer and lives with her now. She is doing fine, too. She's 84 with stage 4 lung cancer. Wow, 84. Well, that's great, Steven. I know you trust the Lord. And, you know, that's the most powerful thing you can do for your health is trust the Lord to uphold and keep you and go about your life living it for Him. And he'll make your time effective. Awesome, yeah. He is the ultimate healer, as Susan says. And this world, we don't have long for this world. You know, like Farva said, maybe his mom and maybe me and maybe others. But, you know, I feel like the terminal agitation has already set in. And I hope it's not premature. I think that time is very short. Are you leaving us, Chandra? Oh, okay. I thought you were leaving. We're tickled to have you, sweetie. Yeah, and let me say, I love each and every one of you very much. Y'all are all very important to me, and I'm very happy to spend time with y'all, and I'm just delighted that any of all of you are here. I don't disagree with anything in the Bible, Rhett, but you do understand that the water baptism is not what saves us. You know, that's our public showing of what we believe. It's the belief and faith in Christ's sacrifice that saves us, and He's the one the only one could allow for the remission of our sin. And you know, if you take it in that literal direction that because you believe you were baptized, then you could say yeah, but you understand it's not the baptism itself that erases your sin. It's a symbol of your sin being erased by that sacrifice of Christ. That's right, Boost. You know, that's what he says. He's not tardy. He's long suffering, so that as many can be saved as possible. And yeah, absolutely, Rhett. What are your thoughts? We're very interested in what you think, and you may teach us something. I agree with that, Rhett. I'm just watching, and Rhett, you know, I thought maybe he has a bigger point or question. That's why I got quiet. I'm just explaining my sitting here. I have no problem. I agree with that, Rhett. Like I said, that salvation is the faith in what Yeshua did. Like I said, you know, the baptism itself is more of a public declaration. You know, the baptism itself does not remove any sin.
It's you're making a public declaration that you have accepted the sacrifice that Christ has provided on your behalf, and the blood is what covers your sin. I mean, for example, I'm sure there are people that lived a faithful, Christ-loving life that for whatever reason were unable to be baptized. And they might not have been able to enter the temple during the temple days, but Christ won't reject them, not if they have a heart for Him. Amen. Like I said, I don't have any problem with that. But again, the baptism, the water itself, has nothing to do with the remission of your sin. It's simply, it's just like the wedding ceremony doesn't have anything to do with the procreation of children. It's a public declaration of the couple's love and their desire to be coupled and remain that way. And it's very much the same way with your water baptism. And yes, I've been baptized twice, and I believe it's important because the Bible tells us so. But it is not the act of God that removes our sin. It is our public declaration that we have accepted that act of God, which was Him giving His life on the cross for our sins in His perfect, unsinned, untainted blood. Well, you know, we don't want to step off and call it ritual because just like Rhett pointed out, Peter says, you know, go and be baptized, and the baptism is to be taken seriously. It's not something to be entered into lightly. You know, remember Philip and the eunuch. You know, the eunuch asked Philip, says, "Well, what keeps me from being baptized now?" He got all excited, and Philip says, "If you believe, then nothing is holding you back." But what Philip didn't say was, if you don't believe, you don't do this. You know, God is not to be trifled with, and the baptism is to be taken very seriously. But again, we don't want to be confused about what saves us. The baptism doesn't save us. That's a man dunking us in water. Christ dying on the cross, shedding His blood, that's what saved us. Okay, Paul, good to see you. Give her our regards. And you know, I'm pretty sure in Jasher, Tater, it tells us that Ham took it. We know that it was on the ark with Noah, and that Ham took it, and that it wound up in the possession of Nimrod. And, you know, there's a passage that talks about when Nimrod became to be a Gibborim. Many Bible scholars are not exactly clear on that, but they also suggest that it seems to indicate that he actually changed. And much conjecture has been if this covering of Adam was involved. I don't know. And one of those interesting things that I long to find out from the Father when we get there. But you know, there's a great deal on it in the book of Jasher. And if you haven't read that, I'm sure I have some electronic copies I can get to you. Well, Rhett, you can condemn me all you want to, brother, and your terminology, calling me a heretic for deviating from the faith of the early church, that tells me you're Catholic, and so I could care less, brother. You've been deceived by your the structure of a church above you. And I don't typically talk like this, but I really hate it when somebody tells me how righteous they are. Brother, I was saved by the blood of Christ, and you can be saved by water all you want to, and you'll enjoy it. Like I said, you know, I can tell that foolish terminology. I was invited to a gathering one time, and it was withheld from me that I was the only non-Catholic there. And, you know, they thought they had invited me in as a toy, and I very nearly punched one of them in his mouth. But, you know, all that apostolic tradition crap, you know, okay, fine. If that's what you want to cling to, go ahead. But let me tell you, the apostles are not going to save you either. Jesus Christ is the only one. We don't have much time, Miss Breeze. We'll have to do trivia tomorrow, sweetheart. We've only got about 8 minutes left, and we typically save the last five for our closing prayer. And at any rate, I think everyone enjoys the trivia, and we'll try to do it tomorrow. I enjoy it as well, but our time has run out. And Rhett, I hope you come back and study with us. I'm very sorry that you got my temper up, but you know, you've been deceived, and it's much easier to deceive a man than it is to convince one that he's been deceived. And, you know, like I said, baptism is just not going to save you, brother. And I love you. I hope that you come to understand, you know, the true saving grace that Christ and Christ alone performed. And, you know, we'll be delighted to have you back if you want to come back. Well, guys, like I said, we're about short time, and we've got a full prayer list. So let's offer the word the Lord a word of thanks, and go over our prayer list and raise our friends up to Him, and then Lord willing, we'll meet together again. I have NIVs, Raven, but I don't have one nearby. Let me look at it in the King James, and He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with His feathers, and under His wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Amen. At any rate, guys, thank you for coming. I love you all. It's a blessing to be here and to talk with you guys. And like I said, I'll be available to you guys later, of course, as always. I talk to you guys all the time. After we close this session, I'll reopen the chat so you guys can chat as much as you want. And we'll try to carry on as normal. Bless you all very much. I love you all very much. It's a great blessing to me. Happy to do it. Thank you for coming. Let's give the Lord a word of thanks. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. May your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Please forgive us our sins as we forgive those that sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Father, we love you. We're just so in awe of all that you've done, Father. And we beg that you'll be with us and continue to teach us and edify us in all your ways, Father. We want to know you. We want to know your truth. And we want to be close to you, Father. You're dear to us. Father, we've got many, many friends that are in need of your help, your guidance, your comfort, your peace, your healing. They just need you, Father. And we want to lift them up to you. And their names, as we know them, Father, are Leah and Sarah, Boost, Crash, Christine, Hayward, and Guy. Father, Hayward's gone away, Father, and we know that he's with you. So we pray for the peace and for Guy, Brother Guy. Paul and Rose, Wesley, Serena and Brett, Janet and Sons, Mills and Jessica, Caveman, Dew, Lyrette, Chrissy, Haley, Dave, Joseph, Georgie, Stephen, Eva, Lori, Valerie, Jordan and Hannah, Samantha, Jessica and Joseph, Lynn, James, Christian, Karen, Pastor Brunson, Cody W., Alex and Darby, Kenny and Dylan, Pam and Cliff, Deplorable Duck, Catherine H. and her children, Sherry, Harold, Debbie G., Donna, Christopher, Rob and Sharon, Brycat, Liz, Mandy, Kimberly, Edric K., Richard, Blue, Susan, Norma and Mark, George, Laura and Tony, Jacob, Ravenwood, Justin, Tristan, Christine, Christy, Joe P., Nathan, Robert W., David W., Mary, Bill and Jeff, Robert F., Ron, Hank, Nathan, Connie and Virginia, Eric, Tidnab, John T., Jane, Dave, Donald H., Ken K., Michael, Tola, Martin, Sean McGee, Kilo Charlie, Eddie Collins, Gail M., Terry and EZ, Lisa and Cara, Matt K., Scott, Billy, Keith, Cat M., Paul, Sage, Girl P. and Girl A., Amber, Krista, Sam and Ezekiel, Stephen Cook, Liesel, Ian W., Julianne, Moo, Patrick, Patty, Mole Mole, Wayne, and Amy. Father, we love you. We know you love them, and we lift them up to you and beg for you to attend their spirits and their souls, Father. Father, we're so grateful. Thank you for this group. Thank you for bringing us together. Thank you for being with us, Father, and we beg to be with you always. And in Yeshua's precious name, we pray. Amen. Amen. And all God's children said, amen. Yeah, thank you guys for coming so much. And like I said, as normal, I'm gonna cut the stream so that for the archive purposes, and then I'll start it back up, and so you guys can chat all you want. We're delighted, Betty. Thank you. We hope you come back. Nicole, do we not have her? Millie, hang on. I thought we have Nicole. But I'll sure add her, sweetie. I guess you were listening, though, so if I'd have said it, you'd have called it out. And possibly we could have two Nicoles, but I thought we had one on her. Anyway, I'm adding her now, Millie. And Peyton. And I will pray for them in my personal prayers. Okay, Millie. Well, I did add her. And like I said, I just glanced over it and I don't see it. We got like 100 names on here. But anyway, I did add Nicole and Peyton. And if there's anyone else that's wanting, that y'all want added that I've missed. And Sean, is that Favre? Gotcha. Gotcha, Favre. I added Sean. Yeah, you guys are welcome. Like I said, I'm delighted to be here and do this with you guys. Okay, well, I'm going to cut the live stream now, and
then I will restart it in just a few minutes. So if you guys want to chat, just hold your seats, and you'll be able to come and go once I start it back. I love you all. Happy Sabbath. I'll talk to you in the chats, and hope to see all of you tomorrow at 5 o'clock. And all right, here we go, guys. I'll talk to you later. Love you all. Happy Sabbath.